I want to talk to you guys today about discernment and discernment of love. Most of all, what is love? So I titled this video Discernment of Love, and I put in parentheses Donald Trump, because Donald Trump has a lot to do with that. And I'll show you the prophecies with it, but I want you guys to understand what true love from God really is. So this is in Matthew chapter 5, verse 43 and 44. These are the words of Jesus, what he says towards our enemies. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. Verse 44, but I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. You know the definition of love in the Hebrew translation is abaha, or ahaba. Love means ahaba in the Hebrew translation. And the word for ahaba means infinite, infinitive, absolute. The Greek translation for love is agape, meaning goodwill, benevolence, perfect. Infinitive, we know, infinitive is never ending. There is no end, therefore it is eternal. But benevolence, the definition of that is perfect love, all loving, therefore perfect love. There is no imperfection in it. Who is the one person we know that is perfect when it comes to love? And that's Jesus. That's God himself. So I want you to understand 1 Corinthians 13, a true meaning about it. I've read this passage so many times, but when I was praying today and when God was showing me how to, when he was telling me to make this video, when he was telling me and showing me, he showed me a different revelation of the scriptures of 1 Corinthians 13. This is verse 1. Though I speak with the tongues of men and angels, but have not love, I become sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. This is the Apostle Paul talking. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, so that I can remove mountains but not have love, I am nothing. And this is verse 3. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned but have not love, it profits me nothing. Verse 4. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself, which is boast. Is not puffed up, does not behave rudely, does not seek its own, is not provoked, thinks no evil, does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in truth, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. So I want you to really pay attention to this as I've read this, and you can read 1 Corinthians 13 on your own. Who does this describe? Aside how the Apostle Paul is talking about Christians, how we are to love one another, if we're praying for someone, if we're prophesying over someone, if we're doing something for someone. But who is the Apostle Paul talking about? He's talking about us. But who is fulfilled? A better question. Who has fulfilled these scriptures already? Jesus. The verses already talk about Jesus. Jesus loves us. Jesus doesn't boast. He doesn't rejoice in evil and iniquity. Iniquity is sin. He doesn't rejoice in sin. He rejoices in nothing but truth. And he believes all things and he bears all things. He bared the sins of the world on the weight of the cross. He bared the sin of the weight of the sin for us. So love is intended to be good, but it has been perverted over many years. So there's also a difference. That's the love how God has intended for us. And this is why I say discernment of love. So if this is the love that we're not following, then what's the love that we've been taught as a culture, as a part of the world where they just indoctrinated us in a false teaching of what love is when God has his own way of love. He has the right way of love. And I'm going to show you the way of love that we've been taught, including myself, how I used to live like this. So I'm going to read you from the New Living Translation. This is 2 Timothy 3, verses 1 through 5. You should know this, Timothy, that in the last days there will be a very difficult time. There will be very difficult times. Verse 2. For people will love only themselves and their money. They will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God, meaning mocking God, disobedient to their parents and ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred, such as marriage, you know, a bunch of the stuff that should be sacred. They will be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good. They will betray their friends, be reckless, and be puffed up with pride, and love pleasure rather than God. Number five, they will act religious, and they will reject the power that could, but they will reject the power that could make them godly. Stay away from people like that. So you see how there's a scripture that actually supports every one of these. So I'm going to use scripture to support scripture. If that's not good enough for you, then okay, Romans chapter 12, verse 19. As God says not to take revenge, this is Apostle Paul speaking again. Dear friends, never take revenge. Leave that to the righteous anger of the Lord. For the scriptures say, I will take revenge. I will pay them back, says the Lord. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 5, verse 20. Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who puts darkness for light and light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Meaning, anytime the Bible refers to anything as woe, the word woe, it means judgment. Judgment is coming upon those. And a lot of people, they twist around the scriptures of Matthew 7, verse 1 through 4 with scripture. They say people, lukewarm Christians, religious people who act like, you know, they act boastful. They act just because they go to church. They think they have all that. No, that's not the thing. When you twist around, they twist around Matthew 7 and they say, don't judge me. But yet they're over here judging someone the same way. And that's the way God's going to judge them. So I'm not saying to go and start judging everyone. I'm saying there is a right way to handle things. If you're going to be judging, of course you have to make a judgment off of everything. You make a judgment, you judge your decisions, you judge someone else's decisions if you're going to follow through. Is it outside of the will of God? Is it? So I'm not saying to go bashing people. I'm not saying to go talk about someone, because Proverbs 18:21 says the power of life and death is in our tongue. I'm saying be careful how you're talking about someone. Be careful how you're judging someone, because the enemy is after your words. And when it comes to that, even on your enemies, when in the beginning when I said this in Matthew chapter 5, verse 43 and 44, Jesus says to pray for our enemies, to forgive our enemies. So this is how it's going to tie into Trump. All right? And it's a very wise thing to be quick to listen but slow to speak. Even if you have anger problems, be quick to listen and slow to speak. I'm going to give you more scriptures. Luke chapter 6, verse 32. What separates you? And this is something you should ask yourself. According to Luke chapter 6, verse 32, what separates you from other sinners? What separates you from other people who reject Jesus? For if ye love them which love you, what thank have ye? Meaning, if you love them that love you, then what do you gain? For sinners also love those who love them. Sinners do the same thing. Better yet, demons can love too. They love iniquity. They love sin. Satan himself, the same thing. So what separates us from him? In the book of James, it says that the demons even believe in Jesus, but they don't trust in him. They don't serve him. So how are we supposed to separate ourselves from the evil that is in this world? Now I'm going to give you one more scripture before I get back to Trump. 1 John chapter 5, verse 2. By this, we know that we love the children of God. We love God and obey his commandments. So if you love God, if you obey God, you obey him because you love him. You love his commandments because it's something you love. It's like following an order. It's like if my mom, or as kids, our mom and dad tell us to clean our room, especially our moms. That's my mom mostly. I struggled with that. And I was a dumb kid. But there's always a time where our parents, especially our moms, they tell us, clean your rooms, and you know, you don't want to do it unless you're actually into it. The same thing when it comes to the scriptures. When you obey God, God says to respect your parents. Respect them because you love God and you love your parents. Obey his commandments, not because you just want to get out of hell, but it's a sin. If you're only obeying God just to stay away from hell, you know that's actually a sin. Because love in 1 Corinthians 13 fulfills everything. Jesus dying on the cross for us fulfilled everything. He fulfilled all the prophecies. God fulfilled every prophecy. And I'm about to give you the prophecies that God showed me. And he showed everyone, a bunch of Christians around the world. And I'm not saying everyone knows this, but I'm saying this is something that everyone has to know. And he's even using someone like Donald Trump. If you can forgive someone like Donald Trump, if you can pray and love someone like Donald Trump, then, hey, God will honor you. He give him all the glory, because a person can't love Donald Trump or pray for Donald Trump unless they have the Holy Ghost in them. So look, I'm going to show you the scriptures that show how God has appointed Donald Trump to be our president. So this is Donald Trump. Donald Trump has a parallel to King Cyrus in Isaiah 45 and Ezra 1. But I'm going to read it to you from my... actually, I'm going to give you the description first. So Donald Trump and King Cyrus, they both weren't believers. This is King Cyrus. King Cyrus was not a believer. He was used for God's purpose to deliver Israel from the Babylonians after 70 years of captivity. Now, I don't know if I had another video on this. If you have me on Facebook or Instagram, you can see where I talk about the prophecies of Ezekiel and Jeremiah. But I'll probably be giving another video. I don't mind explaining again, so I can post this on YouTube also. But I talk about the prophecies of Jeremiah chapter 25, verse 12 and 13. So I'm going to read it to you so you can have a better description. Just picture it in your head. Close your eyes if you have to. If you're hearing my voice, close your eyes and just picture it all in your head for my words, what God says in his word. Chapter 25 of verse 12 and 13 of the book of Jeremiah. So verse 12. But when 70 years are complete, I will punish the king of Babylon, this is God speaking, and that nation and the land of the Chaldeans for their guilt, declares the Lord, and I will make it an everlasting desolation. Verse 13. I will bring upon that land all the words I pronounce against it, all that is written in this book, which Jeremiah, that's a prophet, has prophesied against all the nations, including us, including everyone, back at that time. This is God prophesying. And that prophecy was fulfilled. In the book of Ezra, chapter 1, verses 1 and 4, it talks about King Cyrus. I need you to understand King Cyrus so you can understand Donald Trump. In the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, to fulfill the word of the Lord spoken through Jeremiah, the Lord stirred the spirit. He stirred the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, to send a proclamation throughout his kingdom and to put it in his writing as it follows. Verse 2, this is what Cyrus, king of Persia, says. The Lord, the God of heaven, who has given me all the kingdoms of the earth, has appointed me. Notice, God appointed King Cyrus, just like he appointed Donald Trump, has appointed me to build a house for him at Jerusalem. And the prophecies you should see all over, the restoration of the Jews, that till Jesus comes back, there would have to be restoration. All the Jews would have to come back to Jerusalem. For him at Jerusalem, in Judah, whoever among you belongs to his people, may his God be with him. This is King Cyrus talking. May his God be with him, and may he go to Jerusalem in Judah and build the house of the Lord, the God of Israel. He is the God who is in Jerusalem, and let every survivor, wherever he lives, be assisted by the men of the region with silver, gold, goods, and livestock, along with freewill offering for the house of God in Jerusalem. So see, and I'm going to show you how the 70 years were fulfilled, and it's fulfilled. God is using the same parallel as he did with Jeremiah in those days with King Cyrus. So in the book of Ezra, chapter 4, verses 4 and 5, it's shown that a council, somewhat like a congress back then in the kingdom of Israel, a council, quote, quote, was hired to frustrate the purpose of King Cyrus. A council was hired to frustrate the purpose of King Cyrus as God appointed him, to frustrate the plans that God had for King Cyrus, even though King Cyrus wasn't really saved. So this prophecy was fulfilled. 70 years Jeremiah prophesied, and it was fulfilled from 606 BC all the way from the Babylonians always taking over Israel, as God prophesied in Jeremiah 25, all the way 606 minus 70. That gives you 536 BC. In 536 BC, King Cyrus is come on the play. King Cyrus is the king that was prophesied, that God gave, that was prophesied according to the word of God. So then you're going to see this. So now you know that, right? Now let's go and apply that with Donald Trump. The paradigm, the parallel. 70 years of Israel's restoration was actually fulfilled in 1948. Because if you have, I'm going to show you all different sides of the prophets, the books that show that Donald Trump has been called by God. And I'm not saying Donald Trump saved. Okay, I'm telling you that we have to pray for our presidents. We have to. And this is actually a test of faith on your discernment of love. Do you have discernment of love, of godly love, not your love? Your definition of good and love is way different compared to God's definition of good and love. So the restoration happened in 1948. 70 years later, in 2017, Jerusalem, capital. Jerusalem was recognized as the capital of Israel by who? Donald Trump, because he was elected in 2016. Let's look at the paradigms between them. Isaiah prophesied of King Cyrus in Isaiah 45. Donald Trump is the 45th president. Donald Trump, his name, Donald, means world ruler. From Jeremiah, his prophecy was fulfilled from 606 to 536 BC until it got to King Cyrus. That was exactly, exactly 70 years, from 1948, after Hitler, was Israel finally reborn, restored up to 2017. And then we got Donald Trump, just like how they got King Cyrus. And this is actually what goes along with prophecy. God has already prophesied the parallels, the paradigms, the historical documents, the history events, according to also Genesis 12, verses 2 and 3. When he tells Abraham, I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and curse those who curse you. And all the families of the earth will be blessed through you. The descendants of Abraham, they will be blessed through the children of Abraham. The children is Israel, and the generations after that and after that. God said, I'm going to bless whoever blesses you. I'm going to curse whoever curses you. Anytime someone steps away from Israel, they do not receive the blessing of God. Anytime someone, because God chose Israel as his first chosen people. So anytime somebody goes against Israel, God's going to go against them. The same way somebody goes and attacks Israel, God's going to attack them the same exact way. And he's fulfilling every single prophecy and using Donald Trump to fulfill the prophecies, whether we like it or not. It's not about being a Republican. It's not about being a Democrat. There is no politics in this. This is all according to the scriptures and what God says in his word. And it's very important to pray for our presidents to have that discernment, even if they are crazy. And I'm going to show you how Donald Trump, yeah, he is crazy. He's prophesied as being crazy. Jehu. Now, there is a paradigm with Jezebel. In 1 King, I think it was from 17 and so on. In 1 King chapter 17 and so on, it talks about this. This is after Ahab. So this actually goes to the parallels between Hillary Clinton, Obama, Donald Trump, and Bill Clinton. So let's just, and you can read it on your own, but just read the paradigm from Jonathan Cahn. I'm going to give you just a brief description. Hillary Clinton represents Jezebel. Ahab represents Bill Clinton, always influenced by Jezebel, just like Bill Clinton always influenced by Hillary Clinton. Obama is the spiritual son, like another spiritual son, another representation of Ahab's son. I think it's Jerome or Jeroboam. But you have Donald Trump represents Jehu, the same parallels, the same paradigm. Later, after Ahab is out of the kingdom, Elijah, this is during the times of Elijah, and I think this was 2 Kings, actually, not 1 Kings. I think it was 1 or 2 Kings, but in the times of Elijah, when Jezebel, she's not the queen anymore, but she's still in the kingdom, and you have this new king, they're going against each other, Jezebel, the former queen, and you have also Jehu, someone who used to be for the He used to be for the worship of Baal, the sacrificing of babies. What do we call the sacrificing of babies nowadays? We call it abortion. Donald Trump used to be for abortion. He used to be for this. But Jehu overcame Jezebel. He took her out of office. Donald Trump overcame. He overcame. It was appointed for him to be elected. He overcame Hillary Clinton. And what happened? He kicked her out of office. It's not a coincidence. And you know, it's also another thing. If you don't believe that paradigm, all right, let's go to the Jubilee mysteries. Jubilee is in Leviticus 26, verses 11 through 13. Jubilee is a celebration that's not one, it's not a day, it's not a month, it's a year. It's every 50 years, according to Leviticus 25, verses 11 through 13. And Jubilee represents a ram, like a trumpet. It stands for, Jubilee means trumpet, like the sounding of the trumpet, just like how there's seven trumpets until Jesus comes back. And the seventh trumpet, he comes back. And seven is actually God's complete number because God finished his last work on the seventh day. It was completed. In the Jubilee mysteries in Leviticus 25, if we go based off of that, and if you haven't seen this on Facebook or Instagram or whatever, I recommend you see it. I talk about Mark Twain. I'm not going to talk too much about it because I got to move on. I don't want to take too much time. But in 1867, Mark Twain went in the year of Jubilee to Israel. He fulfilled a prophecy according to Deuteronomy 29 that Moses prophesied to the children of Israel about the generations later on. But Mark Twain, Samuel Clemens, Huckleberry Finn, the one who made Huckleberry Finn, the author of Huckleberry Finn and Tom Sawyer, he went in the year of Jubilee in 1867. 50 years later, his Jubilee does not only mean every 50 years, but Jubilee also stands for liberty. Whatever the owners had taken away, they're going to get it back. It's a celebration of freedom, restoration. It's a biblical celebration for the Jews from the Jewish customs. 1867, add on 50 years, you get 1917. In 1917, you have Great Britain. They actually blessed Israel. They took over the Ottoman Empire that took over Israel. They weren't even known as Israel. They were known as Palestine, because the Ottoman Empire, we know them as Turkey, they took over Israel. And Great Britain defeated the Ottoman Empire and made a declaration of Balfour saying that the Jews can go home and live in their home. 1917. And at that time, God made, according to Genesis 12, God made Great Britain a great nation. Then later on, 1917, add on 50 years later, 1967, the soldiers walked into the gates of Jerusalem, into Israel. But 1967 plus 50, another 50 years of Jubilee, 2017, Donald Trump recognizes Jerusalem as the capital of Israel. He recognized them. Not once did any other kingdom, not once did any other president recognize, they never recognized Jerusalem as the capital of Israel. They never recognized Israel. And look how they're restored. So the second coming of Christ, the prophecy shows that there will be a restoration of the Jews in Jerusalem, where it all started, where the ministry started, where everything started, and Jesus will be coming back exactly to Jerusalem. So now, if you know the prophecies, if you understand, which you should, I tried breaking down as good as I can, what should we do when it comes to discerning love? Pray for our authorities, including Donald Trump. Proverbs chapter 21, verse 1, the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. Like the rivers of water, he turns it wherever he wishes. Meaning God can turn someone's heart wherever he wants. He can touch someone's heart. He can use anyone, whoever he wants. We're not better than one or the other. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. The Apostle Paul says that we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, in the heavenly places. It's a spiritual warfare. We shouldn't be talking against using witchcraft. Proverbs 18:21. We shouldn't be speaking death according to the flesh of someone else. We can't be speaking against our brothers and sisters. In Psalm chapter 2, verses 1 through 3, why do the nations rage and the people plot in vain? The kings of the earth take their stand, and the rulers gather together to counsel against the Lord and against his anointed one. Let us break their chains and cast away their cords. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1 in the ESV version. First of all, then I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for all God's people, or for all people. Verse 2, for kings and all those in authority, so that we may lead peacefulness, or in tranquil, meaning calmness, and a quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. Verse 3, this is good and it is pleasing in the sight of God our Savior. Verse 4, who desires all people to be saved, including Donald Trump, and to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now I'm ending it off like that. Why do I say this? I don't say this to promote Trump. I'm not any more of a fan of him. I'm not a fan, all right? I'm not in the Trump train. I'm not trying to classify myself as a conservative or only conservative. I'm not, all right, look, I only go with what God says, with the word of God, and it's not political. It's a spiritual warfare, and there's an Antichrist system reigning. There's a spirit of Jezebel and all this. So I say this to challenge, so you can challenge yourself. Ask yourself this question. Challenge yourself and ask yourself, do I really love according to God? Do I really love according to God's word? Can I love the way God tells me to? I just gave you scripture for scripture. I know I didn't talk as much. I talked a lot, but I didn't talk as much off of my own words because I wanted to give a bunch of scriptures, every scripture to support every word that I speak, that God told me to speak, because I know there's going to be people bashing me. I've had people speak witchcraft against me. I've had people curse me. I've had people, I've had a bunch of spiritual attacks towards me for speaking up. And I'm not boasting. I'm saying I wouldn't be doing this if I didn't care. I wouldn't be doing this if I was ignorant. I'm not ignorant. And this isn't my wisdom. It's not my words. I'm giving you scripture. So I say that you just pray about it. And I challenge you to compare yourself, not with me, not with anyone, not even with Trump. Compare yourself with the scripture. Can I love Donald Trump like he's another person? Therefore, should we just bash him? Should we speak against him? Should we cuss him out? Should we talk about him? Even if they're on the other side of the world, we still fall into sin if we even speak about someone if we even speak about someone falsely, or if we even cuss about someone, if we even curse someone, we should be praying for our presidents. We should be praying for our authorities, our governments, at least for God to move in them or to move in their hearts. Because if we're over here getting away from God, just like we kicked out God out of the schools, now look what happens to the schools. The same thing, if we kick out God out of our country, if we get away from God's will, his commandments, outside of our country, then what happens? We will all fall into desolation, especially living in the last days. So I gave you a scripture for every word I said, and scripture supports scripture. I don't have my opinion in this. So I just, I hope you guys really understand this. And if you want to message me, you still want to talk to me, if you still don't understand, I can break it down for you one-on-one. I don't mind at all. I don't mind repeating myself. But I hope you guys really understand this, and God bless you.